رضي الله تعالى عنه قال: كنا مع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم في غزوة. That we were with the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم on a war expedition. He said, and when I caught one of the non-Muslims between two rocks, إذ رفعت سيفي قال لا إله إلا الله. And when I lift my sword up to kill the individual, he uttered the shahada, La ilaha illallah. Usama, he says, so I killed him. فطعنته في برمحي. So I poked him, or I stabbed him with my spear anyway. He said, فلما رجعنا إلى المدينة, and when we returned back to Medina, أخبر النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم بذلك. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was informed about what I did. He said, فجاءني النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وقال يا أسامة قتلته بعد أن قال لا إله إلا الله. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked me, Usama, did you kill him after he said لا إله إلا الله? Usama, he said, in defense of himself, ما قال ذلك إلا مخافة من سيفي. He only said that because he feared my sword. He knew I was getting ready to kill him. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked him again, أَقَتَلْتُهُ بَعْدَ أَنْ قَالَ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ. Did you kill him after he said لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ? He said, يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ مَا قَالَ ذَلِكَ إِلَّا مَخَافَةً مِنْ سَيْفِي. He only said that because he feared my sword. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked him, أَشَقَقْتَ عَنْ صَدْرِهِ حَتَّى تَرَى هَلْ هُوَ مُؤْمِنٌ. Did you open his chest open to see whether he really believed? أَشَقَقْتَ عَنْ صَدْرِهِ. Did you open his chest to see whether he really believed or not? Meaning that is not your call. You don't make the judgment call. That is not your call to say whether someone believes or not. That is not your call. You are not the judge. The Prophet ﷺ said to Usama, further emphasizing the severity of what he did, he said, وَمَاذَا تَفْعَلُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ بِقَوْلِهِ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ. He said, what are you going to do on the day of judgment about his statement, لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهُ? What are you going to do, يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ, when you stand before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Allah question you about why you killed this man after he said La ilaha illallah? And Usama, he said, Laytani aslamtu dhalika al-yawm. I wish I had accepted Islam on that day, meaning so I had not committed that sin and it would have been erased from my slate. The moral of this story is that, number one, we deal with people based upon what they display to us on the outside. And we leave the sara'ir, we leave what is in their chest, what their secret intentions are, to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is not for me to judge or for anyone else to judge. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, يَعْلَمُونَ ظَاهِرًا مِنْ حَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَهُمْ عَنِ الْآخِرَةِ هُمْ غَافِلُونَ. That you only know the outward appearance of this life, but as it relates to what is hidden from the hereafter, you have no clue about. You only know this life. You only know what is vahir, what is apparent to you. But as it relates to the hidden treasures of the hereafter and what is going to take place in the hereafter, huma anha ghafilun, you are heedless. You have no clue. Who's going to be forgiven? Who's not going to be forgiven? Wallahu alazim, laysa shanuk. It has nothing to do with you. And today, subhanAllah, we have become so judgmental, even as Muslims. And we should know this. We play the role of God today. We play the role of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala today. And we tell everybody who's going to paradise and who's not going to paradise. MashaAllah, tabarakAllah. MashaAllah. So you know that I'm going to the hellfire. MashaAllah, tabarakAllah. And it doesn't matter how great the sin a person may be engaged in. You don't know what deeds the person has done that because of that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may forgive them. And you don't know that because you believe that you are better than everyone else, that Allah may not forgive you. As the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned in the Hadith al-Qudsi, where a man said to another man, "Inna Allah la yaghfiru lak," that Allah will never forgive you. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Man yata'ala alayya an la aghfiru li fulan fa inni kad ghafartu lahu wa la aghfiru lak." Who is it that puts himself as a god before me to say that I will not forgive so-and-so? Indeed, I have forgiven so-and-so, and I do not forgive you. Hadith al-Qudsi. So, you know, we don't want to get in the habit of being judgmental of people and saying who's going to be forgiven, who's not going to be forgiven. Judging what is in people's hearts, that is not your call. That is not what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created you for, to look into the hearts of people. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam lived in Medina, and in his midst, there were hypocrites, munafiqun, hypocrites, clear hypocrites. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala named the whole surah in the Quran, al-munafiqun, the chapter of the hypocrites. In the first, you know, a group of verses in Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes the hypocrites. وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَقُولُونَ آمَنَّا بِاللَّهِ وَبِالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ وَمَا هُمْ بِمُؤْمِنِينَ. And then from amongst people are those who say, "We believe in Allah on the last day," but they are not believers. And we have hypocrites amongst us today, people who say that I'm Muslim. They carry Muslim names, they come from Muslim families, but they are not Muslim. But is it my job or your job to discern and to distinguish who is who? That's not our job. And even though the Prophet ﷺ knew this element was prevalent in his community, he never made it his job to expose who was a hypocrite and who was not a hypocrite. If they established the salah, he treated them no differently than he treated his own companions. And he knew exactly who they were. He knew exactly who they were. Even when the chief of the hypocrites, Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul, when he created this accusation against Aisha, accusing her of adultery, the Prophet ﷺ never got on the minbar and exposed him. He knew who it was. He knew who was behind it. He never exposed him. Even when the hypocrite stood up and said, "Ya Muhammad, ittaqillah, fear Allah, wa'adil fil qisma, and be fair in your distribution of the spoils of war." Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, "Ya Rasulullah, da'ni adrib uluk hadha munafiq." O Messenger of Allah, leave me to strike the neck of this hypocrite. He was a hypocrite. What did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say? He said, "La ya Umar, fa inni akhafu an yakul al-nas anna Muhammad yaqtulu ashaba." He said, "No, Umar, I fear people will say, if you do this, I fear people will say Muhammad kills his companions." The individual wasn't one of his companions. He was clearly a hypocrite. But the Prophet ﷺ treated him as one of his own companions. He never exposed them, because that's not our job to expose. But if people display outwardly that they're Muslim, then we deal with them as Muslims. If people display other than that, then we deal with them accordingly. But it is not your job, not my job, to look into someone's heart to see whether or not they believe, or to judge whether or not the person is going to paradise. And I'll leave with this example. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he mentioned about a prostitute from Bani Israel. Prostitute, here's a woman who sells her body for money. Sells her body for money. And most people would look at someone of this nature and say automatically the person is going to hell. Because that's just the judgmental nature of people who believe that they are religious. We believe that I'm religious, I have a station closer with Allah than everybody else. And this is the same thing that Bani Israel fell into when they believed that they were the chosen people of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And you have Muslims who fall into the same thing. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in the Quran that they said, "Nahnu abna Allahi wa ahibba'a," that we are the children of God and we are His most beloved. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refutes this. Allah said, وَلِمَا يُعَذِّبُكُمْ بِذُنُوبِكُمْ بَلْ أَنْتُمْ بَشَرٌ مِّمَّنْ خَلَقٍ. Then why is it, if you are the chosen and the children of God and His most beloved, then why does He punish you for your sins? Rather, you are children from amongst the children that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created. بَلْ أَنْتُمْ بَشَرٌ مِّمَّنْ خَلَقٍ. You are human beings from the human race that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created. You have no special station with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Muslims, we fall into that today. We pray and we fast and we believe that we have a station or position with Allah that no one else has. MashaAllah. You don't determine that. Allah does. And the prostitute, as the Prophet ﷺ mentioned, she went down into the well and she got herself some water. And when she came up out of the well, she noticed a dog panting heavily out of thirst. She sympathized and empathized with the dog. The dog is feeling thirsty just as she felt thirsty a few minutes ago. She got back down into the well and she put the water in her shoe and she put the shoe in her mouth and climbed back out of the well and gave the dog a drink of water. And the Prophet ﷺ said that Allah forgave her for her sins. This was a prostitute. So while everybody may judge her and look at her and say she's going to hell, because she's a prostitute, she's despicable, she's this, she's that, right? She's done something in her life that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has forgiven her for. And for while we judge the person, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may not forgive us. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. Wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam tasleeman kathira. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.